Welcome to Trinity TV and welcome to your favorite show on a Thursday night, Shepherd's Corner.
On a Sunday morning.
On a Sunday morning. And on a Tuesday, we have them on Sky 99.5
right.
FM.
Cover all your times.
We cover it all your times. And we want to welcome you and thank you for tuning in. Today, His Grace is going to be talking about creation. Creation time. Yes, that's the time we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about creation time. And so the question is, why all this fuss about creation? You have so many people saying, no, man, that is normal. This has happened all the time. It's just cyclic. We are not doing anything to destroy creation.
Well, you know, plenty of people have their heads in the sand. And, you know, when you see a train coming towards another train, somebody better move. And we on a wreck. Our pathway as a planet right now is on a wreck. And there are all sorts of things that we already know. The science is already there. The science is already telling us. And we in the Caribbean, we should know better than anybody else because we've experienced unprecedented heat and unprecedented rainfall, unprecedented hurricane activity over the last 5 years.
So why are people so blind that creation is crying out? What is it that some cannot see?
You just said it, you know. Those who are blind and they cannot see. You know, it's a difficult one. Once I attended a World Urban Forum, and they had a guy giving a lecture, and he said something that blew my mind. He said, the deepest ailment of Western civilization is oil addiction.
Oil addiction.
Yeah. The addiction to oil.
Yeah.
And then he unpacked it. Air condition is an oil addiction,
Air condition is an oil addiction.
It burning oil for fuel.
That's right.
A motor car.
Yeah.
A plane.
Yeah.
A television. Everything that we do in the modern world is only possible because of oil. And it's not as if we are in this in a way that is neutral. We are now addicted to the lifestyle that oil has produced for us, and therefore we cannot see anything else but this lifestyle, and therefore we don't want to see anything that tells us that something in our lifestyle has to change, and therefore it can't be right, or that's not going to affect me, or that's somebody else's problem. And all of those are non-starters.
No, that's that. What you just said there, I love that oil addiction thing, because for many people, we don't look at it. We don't look at it from the start to the finish.
No.
We watch the television, we watch the car, we watch the ice creams we have, we watch
all of that is
the lifestyle.
Only possible because of oil. Before oil, we had none of that, you know. Before we harvested oil, none of that existed. Oil allowed us to have a lifestyle. So the oil addiction is really the lifestyle. Those things are the things that are propping up our lifestyle. A cell phone, can't have it without oil. Your watch, your glasses, anything plastic.
This is definitely from oil.
So this addiction to our lifestyle, he's translated it to be an addiction to oil. Because it is oil that has allowed the lifestyle, And therefore, because we are addicted to the oil, to the lifestyle, we are unwilling to hear that that our lifestyle is causing a problem in our planet. And that's a problem.
I think it's only a problem when we hear ourselves, we have to make a change or give up something.
Absolutely. And that's the addiction. That's why he's called it oil addiction. Because if I'm an alcoholic and I could keep drinking, I have no problem.
You do.
If I'm a cocaine addict and I could keep smoking, I have no problem. It's when you ask me to do away with my drug of choice that I start to have a problem. And once you're asking me to do away with the drug of choice, then you're asking me to curb my lifestyle. You're asking me to come into withdrawals. I start shaking already. You're asking me to have a conversion of heart. And all of that is what the Holy Father is asking in Laudato Si. And that's the nature of the debate around the Synod of the Amazon that is taking place in Rome in these days.
You know, you said that Pope Francis put a spotlight on the destruction we cause to the creation. He calls creation our common home. And this, you said, is a wonderful image.
It's an amazing image. You know, he has an incredible capacity for naming things in a way that fills out into three dimensions in your mind. So you talk about the planet, well, that's so big. You call it our common home. You've done two things there. First is my home, but it is our common home. So he's done the beginning of the Our Father by uniting us now in our connection with this common home called Earth. And therefore, we all together are united in caring for this planet. And therefore, I have a responsibility and we have a responsibility for the planet.
What a wonderful image.
It's an incredible image. And it is brilliant. It's brilliant. Because if you saw that there was something that was destructive to your home, would you sit down and say, well, what are you going to do? You can't do nothing about it?
Definitely not.
If they had a water leak that was going to cause your foundations to collapse, and would you just say, well, what are you going to do? That's how the water wants to run. I can't do nothing about that. And see your whole foundation crack and then the house come down. And would you do that?
No.
So the same thing that we would do for our physical home is the same thing we have to do for our common home. We can't just accept the fact that it is being destroyed. We have to do something to preserve it.
And you said, you know, it belongs to us. It also belongs to the generations who are yet unborn.
And we only have one, you know.
Yeah.
It's not as if this one go bad, we could say, well, you know, we're going to take our holiday resort instead. Eh?
Yeah.
And it's important in terms of stewardship that we understand that we are only holding the earth in trust for the generations that are still to come. It's not mine to do it as I want. Because there are generations that come, and this is the only home that they're going to have. And so I have to hand on this home to them better than I received it. And that's a stewardship requirement. And that's all part of this image of the earth as our common home.
This ecological crisis, you know, you mentioned that this was not only Pope Francis that mentioned it, but also some of the other fathers.
Oh, Pope Benedict has said things on it. Pope John Paul has made comments on it. And each one has called for a stewardship of creation. And that we hold the creation in trust on behalf of God. And those who are yet unborn, we must take proper care of it and ensure that we hand it on to the next generation.
In a better condition.
In a better condition. All the Holy Fathers have made statements on the earth as something that deserves all of our attention because it is something that is so real right now that we have to preserve the earth no matter what we do.
Did the Antilles Episcopal Conference also have a position?
Yes. In 2015, we did a declaration on climate change, and we said that we recognize that climate change represents a significant threat to the sustainability of Caribbean life as we know it. Our nations are already impacted by unusually heavy rainfall. It's 2015, eh? Mm-hmm. Unusually heavy rainfall, warmer temperatures, prolonged periods of drought, rising sea levels, and the prospect of more intense storm events. Though we concentrate on the Caribbean region, we are mindful that we are a part of a planet. The scientists have told us that nature has been damaged in an unprecedented degree. And Pope John Paul referring to the ecological crisis as a moral problem. And the bishops note that change in temperatures and rainfall negatively impact the productivity of agriculture, storms, and becomes more frequent, more devastating, such as Katrina, Ivan, Sandy, and the devastating rains that struck the Eastern Caribbean in 2013.
Right.
And that's not even counting for what happened in 2017. So in 2015, the bishops, we were in Jamaica, we sat and we reflected on ecology. We had somebody present to us. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that is clear is that we are the second most vulnerable area in the world.
When I read your article, I said, the Caribbean, the second most vulnerable
Absolutely.
Place in the whole wide world. You know, we are a little dot.
Yeah. But this dot is a vulnerable dot. The Pacific Islands and us are most vulnerable. Because if global warming goes where it is going and nothing changes, it is now escalating. Some scientists are predicting that we only have 12 years before we have irreversible damage to the planet.
Wow.
12 years before we have irreversible damage to the planet. That's crazy. And we all going along as if there is nothing that is wrong, and as if this is normal business as usual. 12 years from now, we would wish we had a rewind button to press. But now we have measures that we could take to slow this thing down. There are things that we can do. But some of the big countries don't believe that there's a problem, and therefore they think this is crying wolf. But the science is the science.
But if they are the ones that are impacting on the world the most, and they're not seeing it, then we're in dire straits.
Absolutely.
How can we get our voice outside then? I mean, if we talk, your article is creation time. If
we are
the second most vulnerable place on the planet because of this, how do we get our voice heard?
Well, And that's the reason why the article is on. You know, there's a young woman, mm-hmm. A young girl who left school to go to the UN.
Yeah.
And she gave a very impassioned speech to the UN. And she said, you know, you are causing this problem. Your resolutions that have no teeth, your constant talk, and doing nothing significant to preserve the planet. We only have one home. And at my age, in my lifetime, this something is going to happen. And you don't seem to care. And she laid blame at the world leaders, which is real courageous.
Yeah. But are they hearing? The question is, are they hearing? This is our common home. The Holy Father has said it over and over.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, it's these big nations who will have to make, along with everybody else, I think they have to be the leaders in
big changes.
Making the
but
changes.
We have to make the big changes too. It's not just, and the nice thing is that every single individual needs to start to make big changes. We all are using resources without thinking about the consequences of its use. All of us, I'm included. If you run two air conditioners at the same time, you could only use one. What's the second one cooling for?
Well, the next room gonna get hot, Archbishop. I mean, you want me to walk from a cold room into?
And when
you're
ready,
know somebody will say.
And when you're ready,
I'll get sick.
When you're ready to go into the next room, turn it on. Turn off this one. Turn on that one. And you see, if you lived in a country like Barbados, you understand how that works very well. Because the electricity bill is so astronomical.
Yes.
You can't afford the oil addiction that we have in Trinidad because everything in electricity has been subsidized for so long. But really and truly, how are we using, you know, one that impacted me recently that I didn't really think much about, when you leave your chargers plugged in.
Yes.
That's also drawing a current that is unnecessary.
Yes.
Good Lord.
Yeah.
You know, there are little things that we do that we could change. You turn on the water to bathe and you leave it running.
Yeah.
Until you got unready,
yeah.
You're wasting both electricity from the pump, electricity from the hot water, and you're wasting water most of all, which is now a very scarce commodity.
You know, it was only the other day that in really recognizing the habits that even I have, you know, you turn on the water to brush your teeth. And you leave it on while you're brushing your teeth.
Yeah.
And you don't realize that water is flowing and wasting and going down the drain and you are brushing your teeth.
Yep.
You just don't have the habit of turning it off.
And turn it back on.
And turn it back on.
But if you were on a boat where you have limited water, you'd have had a little cup. You'd use the water to pour on the toothbrush. You'd brush your teeth and you would brush your teeth using one less than a cup of water.
Yeah.
With no problem. So it's really our lack of consciousness that is the problem, and that is escalating the negative impact on creation.
You talked about in 2017, three particular destructive hurricanes affected the Caribbean: Irma,
yes.
Jose, and Maria.
Gosh, they were that was crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I remember both Dominica, Antigua, and the Bahamas, who got hit again in 2018, again in 2019.
Yeah.
Now, this is the worst hit that they've got.
Yes, yes.
So, yes, it's really destruction.
In terms of the estimates, you said the three caused nearly $300 billion in damage.
Yep.
And you said Dorian has unleashed its fury this year on the Bahamas, and the last 19 years have been the hottest on record, each year surpassing the record for the year before.
That says that something is wrong.
But if all the numbers adding up, if all the numbers are pointing in one direction, why is it we can't see it?
Because does an addict want to change their lifestyle?
But he feels like he can't change. He feels like, you want me to give up the cocaine?
Does an addict change their lifestyle easily?
No.
So if this professor was right that what we're facing is oil addiction, you understand why we can't just change our lifestyle? Because this is not rationality. This is irrationality at work.
Whether we like it or not, you said we are in a cycle of climate change and it is having a devastating impact on the Caribbean life as we know it. The Caribbean, again, you said, is the second most vulnerable region on the planet to climate change. And we are seeing this already.
Absolutely.
In the destruction we experienced in 2017 and 2019. And according to the Global Climate Risk Index, Puerto Rico, number one, and Dominica, number three, were among 10 countries most affected by climate change in 2017.
Isn't that amazing?
No.
And when I said we are in the second most vulnerable area, you thought, nah, you must be talking stupidness.
Yeah, because they have, look, they have places all over.
Right. But the Global Climate Risk Index points out Dominica and Puerto Rico as very high on the international scale. And it's something we in the Caribbean have the most to lose. Eh? So if climate warming continues, the icebergs start melting, all the polar ice melts, it's done heading there already. Yeah?
Yeah.
You're going to have a sea level rise.
Yeah.
They estimate as much as 6 feet. Now, our most valuable property is not 1 foot or 2 feet above sea level.
Correct.
So all of our valuable property in the Caribbean is really where our beaches, our resorts, our hotels, all of these things are. So if you go, let's even have 3 feet rise.
6 feet, I can't even think about that.
3 feet rise in sea level, this high.
Yeah.
Which means that the roads outside of Maracas Bay will be getting some water once you have some wind and some surf.
But we see it already in the Manzanilla Stretch.
Yes.
We see it already in the creek.
Correct.
You know, we see it down Icacas, how much land we've lost. This in Trinidad and Tobago.
That carcass is losing how many feet of land?
Miara
is losing land too?
Yes.
Okay. So once you have the rise in sea level and your most valuable property is your sea level property, what happens to your country?
You're going to lose income because
right.
if those are where you have your hotel resorts and
Good.
So on, and that
An
for
asset.
Many Caribbean islands, that's their bread and butter.
And you're going to lose asset because if you owned a property on a seafront that was worth $50 million, 3 feet high of water going into your basement, that is absolutely no value to anybody.
Yeah.
Unless you get the Dutch down and they do like Amsterdam and they build their dikes and their dams and ensure that you keep your things afloat.
You said the heart of the problem, Pope Francis, in his encyclical Laudato Si, says the ecological crisis is also a summons to profound interior conversion.
Mm-hmm. Because if you believe that there's something that we are doing that is creating a problem for the planet, then, and we are not willing to address it by rationality alone, we're not willing to address it and do something different, then that requires conversion. And that interior conversion is a process by which we come to terms with our addiction to oil and make a choice for the lifestyle we will choose and therefore make a choice for what we will do about the planet and about the crisis that we're facing.
Let me bowl you a Chinaman.
You go
we
ahead.
Have 1.1 billion Catholics. Are they listening to Papa Francis when he speaks in Laudato Si? What about the rest of the Christians? I mean, they must hear also that call. I mean, we're not stupid people. We're bright. You know, this is real. This is not, we're not going to the movies and seeing something that is somebody produced and it's not real because we are experiencing it. You know, it's real. What's the challenge then? You need some water.
Just smiling. You know, I'm smiling. Today somebody said to me in a comment, it really took me back, eh? You see, you know, Laudato Si is a Marxist document.
He said it's a Marxist
yes, document. Yes, 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 yes.
Marxist document.
Because it's looking at equality among all people and equality with the creation. And if we pursue this, then we would be going against the heart of our Catholic tradition or something to that extent. And I'm saying to myself, where are we living?
You didn't ask him what he smoked.
No. Where are we living?
Yeah.
Why? Because if we don't understand we have a problem, then we can't do anything to find a solution.
Right.
And this person clearly did not get the memo that we have a problem, that there's something that is fundamentally wrong that has to be addressed, that it is a problem that is going to affect generations to come. And if we don't address it now, it will be too late by the time we decide to wake up and start addressing it. That in fact, we only have about 12 years from this date before we fundamentally, permanently damage the ecology in a way that will be irreversible.
It must be said that some committed and prayerful Christians, with the excuse of realism and pragmatism, tend to ridicule expressions of concern for the environment. Was that a fella who was a Christian?
I don't know.
Did he say, well, what are you talking about, Archbishop Jason?
Well, basically, they're saying that there's no problem or or that the Laudato Si philosophy is flawed, or that they're talking about things that are unreal, or I.
So they didn't see the flood. When Karen was heading here, I wonder what they thought.
And prayer turned it away.
Yeah.
When prayer turned away, Karen. When the rains last year fell and we had so much flooding.
Yeah.
When the storms this year in the rest of the Caribbean. I don't know.
So I don't know
what they're seeing, but what they're not seeing is worrying me.
I'm just thinking, you know, and I want to know what you all are thinking outside there. You feel that we could pray away all of these things?
Well, you know, there's that second temptation, eh? Where he went up to the parapet of the tower. and up on the parapet, the devil tell him, man, you is God's son.
Yeah.
You jump. Not one thing ain't gonna happen to you. You jump now, man. Nothing ain't gonna happen. But that's the sin that's the temptation of you know, being foolish. Yeah. That's the temptation of that's not faith. That's foolishness or dotishness. Because you're presuming upon God for things that you should take care of for yourself. So that's the sin of presumption.
I like that you said. You have those that we just mentioned before. Mm-hmm. They said you have others who are passive. They choose not to change their habits and thus become inconsistent.
Mm-hmm.
So what they all need is an ecological conversion.
Yes.
Whereby the effects of their encounter with Jesus Christ become evident in their relationship with the world around them.
Mm-hmm. Because that encounter with Christ and this world that he has given to us, we can't separate them out. We can't separate them out. Somehow people think that we are guaranteed this world forever and ever and ever. Amen. But if we keep doing what we're doing to the planet is not going to continue giving us what we need to be sustainable as human beings. That's the bottom line.
You said, you know, is this part of our vocation?
I believe it is, because the first thing when God created the world, he said, it good. It's sweet, 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 too bad. And then he said, go multiply, preserve, protect. And that double command was not to subdue in the sense of making it serve you. It's really a priestly command that was given to Adam to look over and to protect the earth. And we don't hear that because we've translated into two English words that kind of mean look over, yes, but kind of, you know, subdue. In other words, do with it anything you want to do with it. And that's not the biblical sense. The biblical sense is the sense that a shepherd would have over his sheep, which is a protective sense and also a nurturing, caring sense. And that sense of what we need to do around the common home, our earth, is that's really the challenge.
You see, living our vocation to be protectors of God's handiwork is essential to life of virtue. It is not an optional or secondary aspect of our Christian experience, and that comes from Laudato Si 217.
Yes, yes.
So that's Papa Francis again.
But it is a vocation. So caring for the earth is a vocation, vocare, to be called. Because if this is our common home, we all have to pitch in caring. Anybody, when you was living in your mother's house, you had chores?
You better believe our chores.
And if you didn't do your chores, what would happen?
Well, you listen, it was either you do your chores or you didn't eat. It's a simple thing.
No, you either did your chores or you didn't live. You didn't exist. So you have to do your chores.
Right.
And it's the same thing. We all have chores to do for our common home, the earth. And we better do those chores. And what chores do we need to do? Well, we need to do chores to ensure that she is around for the next millennia, or 10, or 25, or
world without end.
A million millennia. Yeah. But we have things that we must do. And every human being has an individual responsibility for protecting the earth.
So, looking at it then, mm-hmm. It has to be a moral problem.
It is a moral problem. Because if you keep throwing plastic outside of your house.
Don't go there.
If you kept throwing plastic outside of your house.
Yes.
Every day, you're coming in, you throw 2 bottles, you throw 5 bottles, you throw 6 bottles. Mosquito come. Cockroach come, rats come, and you keep throwing bottles. What kind of problem are we calling that?
Listen, that's a serious moral problem. I am littering. I am not only that, but I am all those bottles and see that I have there. I'm going to cause dengue. I'm going to cause my neighbors to get bitten and get chikungunya, all those kinds of things, right? But. Now, you said the destruction of creation is a moral problem. Mm-hmm. It is a human problem, a problem of sin and greed and hubris.
Yes. It is the worst form of immorality.
I listen, you ever drive behind a maxi taxi or any car and you see somebody just throw out a plastic
It's driving me to drink all the time.
Oh, drink?
It's driving me. I go crazy
yes. when I see that.
But. We have to see from time to time I kayak.
Yeah.
The other day I was out on the water. And if you see plastic floating all over the water.
Yes.
Right there off the foreshore.
Yeah.
Plastic floating everywhere. What problem is that? When people have an old fridge, an old stove, a chair, this or that, and they don't know what to do with it, and they dump it in the water course. And then the next big rain comes, is blocking the water course. And that means that the flooding becomes worse than it should become because the water can't flow, which means damage to people. What kind of problem is it? What is the nature of that problem? When we cut the hills and we slash and burn the hills just so that we could quickly make a little garden and plant some quick crop to go again, And next big rain, that flows, all that earth flows down to what's below, and a landslide happens, and on and on and on.
Somebody loses their house.
Or their life.
Or their life.
What kind of problem is that? This is a moral problem. It is a moral problem. If we do not care for the earth, that is a moral problem. And there's no way around it. And until we are willing to face and accept the facts, we cannot move forward. We're in a deep, deep challenge.
In a sense, it's sinful.
In a sense?
In a sense.
It has only to be in a sense.
It's a big
only
sin.
In a sense.
All right.
Okay.
But how do we bring that? As its heart, it is a deeply spiritual challenge just to recognize that it is sin.
And that's why Pope Francis is writing the way he's writing. Because this is a moral problem. And that's why he talks about conversion of heart, or an ecological conversion. Because until we are willing to shift our lifestyle, we're not going to do what we need to do to preserve our earth. And that's what it comes down to. Oil addiction. Lifestyle addiction.
How we treat the environment is an extension of how we treat others.
Hmm. Yes.
You wrote that, not me.
I know.
You think that the man pelting the dumping the fridge inside of the river course, throwing the plastic
yes.
bottle, could see that that is an extension of how we treat others. Man, listen, man, I don't want... I can't pay for them to come and pick up this old stove. You know how much money it'll cost me to move this old car, this derelict? So what do? We dump it. We
dump
park it
down.
Up on the side
dump
road. We
down.
Push it by somebody,
yeah.
Vacant lot.
Mm-hmm.
you know. Mm-hmm. But what you're saying is, this is an extension of how we treat others.
Each other. You know, in our part of the world, the body of the woman and the earth were treated the same way.
The body of the woman and the earth were treated
the same way. The same way that they would rape and pillage on the earth was the same way they would rape and pillage on the woman.
I never got that connection.
When the conquistadors came, how they treated the earth and how they treated the body of the woman was the same thing. And how we treat the earth and how we treat each other is the same thing.
Because
it's flowing out of one logic and it's flowing out of one ethic. And if I can't respect you, I'm not going to respect the earth.
You know, you linking up something here that is blowing my mind. You're linking up how I treat the environment an extension of, and you're linking this thing with woman, you know.
Yes.
You realize that how much disrespect, you're talking about pornography, you're talking about
everything.
Human trafficking.
We talk
all
about
of this.
Domestic violence. We talk about domestic violence. We're talking about disrespecting. We're talking about the full range of our negativity towards women and the full range of the negativity of how we're treating the environment. They're not disconnected. They're totally interconnected.
And never linked the environment and our women. Never linked the environment. Okay, I can see the environment and how we treat others. You know, I could, but you have me there.
All I'm saying is in this Caribbean space, in this New World space, when the conquistadors came, how they treated the earth and how they treated the woman was the same thing. And both were terrible.
Now, people, you're watching on Shepherd's Corner. And the Holy Father, to address this challenge, a special synod of the Amazon is taking place in Rome right now. It started on Sunday, October the 6th.
You saw the opening mass?
I didn't see the opening
mass. It
was
brilliant. It was brilliant, brilliant.
Wow.
Papa Francisco, brilliant. Gave a great message about the environment, about the Amazonia, and our need to preserve this area because it's the lungs of the planet, 20% of the oxygen and water of the planet is in this basin. And so he was very good.
Brothers and sisters, this thing goes from October the 6th to the 27th. I want to encourage you all to just tap in. You know, you Google for all kinds of things. Google and find out what is happening
in the Amazonian Synod.
And
don't take the fake news about it. Because that's another thing. The Western world only knows one thing about the Amazonian Synod, and that's the question about whether or not the native people should be allowed to be priests as married people. That's the only thing they know about
the
synod.
That's all you're hearing.
But that's the only piece of news on the synod. One piece of news, and that's it. Well, okay.
In its whole purpose, it's to find new ways for the evangelization of that portion of the people of God, especially of the Indians, often forgotten and without the prospect of a serene future, also because of the crisis of the Amazon forest.
Well, you know, the Amazon Synod is an intriguing one. Huh? 9 countries are involved in it. 3 of our dioceses in the AEC bishops are involved in it. Cayenne, French Guyana, Suriname, or Dutch Guyana, and Guyana, which is British Guyana. Mm-hmm. The 3 Guyanas are connected because their rivers flow into the Amazonian basin and river. And so those bishops, together with our president, Bishop Marzen, have gone to Rome for this synod. And you know, the position is very intriguing because this part of the world, the Amazon, is so important for the ecological stability of our world. Culturally, it is so unique because the many people living in the Amazon right now are living a culture that is totally different from the Western culture. We will not understand it. Many have come out into cities, mm-hmm. but many have chosen to remain inside of the Amazon. How do we care for them? How do we evangelize them? How do we give them appropriate care and nurturing to ensure their flourishing? That's really the question of the synod. And that's a big thing. Because if we're going to link caring for the Amazon as a region, then we have to care for the people living in the Amazon. And that means that the big farming that will come and cut down mm-hmm. 200 or 500 acres at a time, that has to stop. Because that's impacting upon the people who are living in there. But it's also impacting upon the whole forest, is impacting upon the ecology and ultimately upon the planet. And so we have to look at this region as a very important region in our world.
You know, we come back again with the colonizers. We come back again with lifestyles. We come back again with
capitalism. That I have the right to rape and pillage the earth regardless of what damage or destruction it does and regardless of who pays that price ultimately. That's the problem. We need a model of sustainable development where my taking out 300 acres of forest involves me planting back 300 acres of forest, so in the next how many ever years that is available, and in a rotation so that every year trees are becoming, so we have to think of forests now as sustainable elements, because we cannot continue taking from the earth and expecting it to replenish at the rates that it did before. It cannot do that.
What can we do? You just mentioned a little bit, right? Whatever your harvest in terms of mm-hmm. lumber and so on, we need to replant so that it will refurbish itself.
So we could recycle.
Definitely.
For instance. So there's a lot of stuff that we throw in away that we can recycle. We could preserve. By not wasting the precious commodity, water, electricity. How are we dealing with those? We could, there are a whole lot of things that we need to be doing in terms of looking at our lifestyle. Do we need all of the electricity that we're using? Do we need all to burn all the gas that we're using? What's your carbon footprint? What is your carbon footprint? Is it in order with the world?
Can people calculate that, your carbon footprint? You know, is there a mathematical formula? Is there an app for that?
I don't know if there's an app for that, but people talk about it enough that there's some way of calculating by how many flights it takes, how much electricity, how much water.
I actually saw that on my airline ticket going to Guyana the other day. It's actually said that.
There's a number of permutations, and that helps you to know what your carbon footprint is.
It would be wonderful for you to know what your carbon footprint is. Mine, what my carbon footprint is for you, my own household. You know, now I don't have any air conditioning, so I mean, I don't have that, but I have a dryer. You know what I mean? Right. I have a gas stove, but I watch television. You spoke about leaving in your power supplies, you know, to recharge your rechargers for your phones and so on like that. And it's still plugged in, even though you're not using it and you're not home.
It's still pulling.
What about leaving your PCs and your laptops on, running 24/7, and you're not in your house?
Right. So there are a number of things that create the carbon or increase the carbon footprint. So let's look at those things. So Pope Francis recently declared September 1st as World Day of Prayer for the Care of Creation. And all of that's gone. It lasts until the October the 4th, which is
the Feast of St. Francis
of Assisi, which is just past us. Mm-hmm. But it's there to help us remember that Francis was brother, son, sister, moon, this connectivity with creation.
It's amazing.
And that's the spirit that we have to come to if we're going to care for this common home we call the earth.
You talked about the season of creation, first observed by the Orthodox Church in 1989 and embraced by Papa Francis in 2015.
Yes. And then in an ecumenical season, you know, it's dedicated to prayer and to the protection of the creation and the promotion of sustainable lifestyles. This year, the theme is the web of life, or the interconnectivity of life.
The web of life.
So think of web in terms of the web, www.
Yeah.
But think of web in terms of the spider's web.
Yeah.
But think of web in terms of the interconnectivity of all of life. That we humans, the animals, the earth, are all interdependent, and therefore we must preserve this home. We have the earth.
You call us stewards of God's creation.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you treating the environment? What is your carbon footprint, as we mentioned before? How much disposable plastic and styrofoam do you use?
You know, we have to stop the styrofoam thing, eh?
Listen.
We have to stop the styrofoam thing, eh?
There's no will.
But we have to stop the styrofoam thing. Because it does not deteriorate. So 100 years from now, that cup and that box is still around and available, eh? 100 years from now. You could bury it, you could do what you want with it. It's not going to go back to earth, as opposed to if you use paper.
Yeah.
It goes back to earth after a very limited time.
Do you have several air conditioners on at the same time? How many devices do you leave plugged in? You know, how long do you run water before you bathe? All of these are serious questions.
Yes.
And what about for business places? Do you leave lights on in your office at night? And sometimes we drive by and you see it. And air conditions, you look up at the towers and you look, notice plenty lights on,
yes.
Nobody is there.
Correct.
Do you dump garbage on the streets, the rivers, and recreational spaces? Now, this is a big peeve of mine. People bring the garbage bags, they fill it up, but they leave it there. They don't take back the garbage with them,
No.
They'll take a garbage bag, fill it up, and tie it up and leave it
If they bring the bag and if they collect. Because many times they don't bring the bag, they don't collect, and they dump right where you are. You go to a beach and there's a whole lot of garbage. No good reason for that. We have to become much better stewards of our creation. Much, much, much better.
Do you recycle? Do you know that IKEA now has bins all over where you all can put your plastics in? Are you a good steward of creation? His Grace is asking us, are you a good steward of creation? Examine yourselves.
You could either join or encourage young people to participate in the season of creation. It's a challenge. It's a creative challenge among youth in Catholic schools and in the parishes. And if you have skills in video, in photojournalism, in poetry, spoken word, or any creative art form, participate in this challenge and raise awareness among young people, among your generation.
So we have in our Catholic Church a season of creation challenge. That's it.
Absolutely. Every year.
Every year. A season of creation challenge.
Challenge.
And I hear they have good prizes.
You know, I hear so too.
Somebody tell me you could get, what, $100 in Amazon or something like that, $100. I wonder if it's $100 US, boy. But look at what you can do. Do you have skills in video, photojournalism, poetry, spoken word, or any creative art, or any creative art form? The challenge that the Catholic Church is putting out to you is to participate in this challenge and raise awareness among your creation. You know, you have iPhones, you want to shoot a little movie? The season of creation challenge.
Yep. So, the St. Francis Canticle Creation Award. The ceremony is going to take place on Saturday, November 9th at Holy Name Convent, the secondary school, where the various projects will be celebrated.
Is this for young people alone, or is it everybody? It was only for young people.
I know you're going to tell me you're young at heart. You know?
Hey!
I know you're going to try and convince me about a thing about you being young and young at heart and all kind of thing.
I cut my hair. I changed my glasses. I hope you won't notice.
No. So you're not young enough. You're not young enough.
So it is for this, students.
This is students.
And, get ready,
and we really, what we want is our young people to really start thinking with the church on this matter. because ultimately they're receiving this common home earth from us, eh? Mm-hmm. Ultimately. Yeah. And therefore, if they don't understand what they need to do and they start adopting our bad habits and lifestyles, they are going to be more mess than we are.
This challenge, everybody, is just one of the many activities promoted in the Caribbean by the Franciscan Institute, a ministry of the Sisters of the Sorrowful Mother. And since 2018, the Institute has collaborated with Global Catholic Climate Movement, Season of Creation, Laudato Si, Generation, local churches and organizations in Grenada, St. Lucia, and in Trinidad and Tobago in sponsoring the challenge. So it's a challenge for you all outside there. And it started in 2018. And we need to push this challenge and get our young people involved. We are baptized.
And we're sent. We are baptized and sent to protect all peoples. We are baptized and sent to protect all peoples and the environment as stewards of our common home, the earth. You know, linking baptism back with caring for creation is a vital link. Because when sin happened in the world, it didn't just affect the human. It affected the creation.
It did.
When sin happened, the four relationships were ruptured. The relationship with God, why are you hiding from God?
Yeah.
You're hiding from God, which means that relationship has been ruptured. Before you walked with him in the cool of the evening naked.
Yeah.
You now start to hide from yourself. I am ashamed. That's why I'm naked. So my relationship with me is ruptured. Your neighbor, because you start blaming and shaming each other.
Yeah.
Ruptured, and the creation. That's why by the sweat of your brow you'll till, and by pain you'll bring forward children. And so the relationship with creation is also ruptured. Salvation is the restoration of these four relationships. And restoring the relationship with God, with each other, with myself, and with the creation, that's the business of salvation.
Now, you've pulled together the whole topic of Shepherd's Corner was all about creation time.
Mm.
Is it real? How we are being stewards or being a lack of a good steward. Mm-hmm. But what's the key message that you want to bring?
Well, creation needs stewards who will call others to conversion of heart to protect it and to protect all of our vulnerable people. And this is so important in our time because of this blindness that we have. If the scientists are right that we only have 12 years before we have an ecological challenge that we cannot reverse.
Yeah.
And that's 12 years is a very, very short time. Eh? Two blinks, a wink, a nod,
yeah.
And we enter the 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
So if they're right, then all the way through these 12 years, we're going to be seeing more and more bizarre facts and more bizarre events around the problem of climate and rain and storms, etc., etc. And if that is so, then what we're going to get is a world, a earth, a planet that is going to be in trouble.
There must be an action step to this.
Yeah. Participate. Participate in the day of prayer for creation. But young people, use your talent to participate in the Season of Creation Challenge. But let's all of us participate in doing something every day for the environment. Just one thing every day. I think if we all did one act of kindness to the environment, that the environment will give us plenty more acts of kindness back to us. But we have to do the one thing to the environment that will really allow this to become real in my life. Because right now, it's kind of out there, somebody else's yeah. problem. It has to become my problem. That's conversion of heart. That means I have to believe it. have to live it, have to act it, have to transmit it to other people.
His grace gave us a couple of things that we can think about in what we do at home. How many air conditioners are running in your house? Do you leave your cell phone chargers, your battery chargers, your tablet chargers plugged in? What about lights on at night? You know, there are some people, I mean, sometimes it's even difficult to watch the stars at night because we have so much light going
up that it stops
us from seeing. It's only like when we go to Mayaro, Toko, or somewhere like that, you can actually see the stars. All of these things are ways in which we can make a difference. Don't throw your plastic bottles out. Don't throw
your stuff. Recycle. Reuse.
Scripture reading.
Genesis, you know. Genesis. God saw that it was good. And God said, it is good. It is
good.
Very good. The creation does not start off in the fall. The fall comes after the creation. The creation starts off with God's original blessing. That God saw it as very, very good. And therefore, we and our interaction with the creation has to see it as a gift. We didn't create the earth. It is God's gift to us. And we ought to treat it as that, as a gift from God. And that's what a steward is. But we've been treating the earth as if we are owners. And because we're treating the earth as if we're owners, we're doing all kinds of things and making our treatment of the earth push the earth further along this craziness that we're living in, where we've come to this juncture where within a couple of years from now, we will do irreparable damage to the environment. And that's what we have to avoid. That's everybody having a conversion of heart, everybody recognizing what we need to do, everybody starting to pull back now, everybody understanding that our water and our food, our electricity, all of these are precious commodities. Let us preserve them.
Creation time. And I think we have to recreate how we think, recreate how we treat our planet. It's a whole, and His Grace is asking us, read Genesis 1.
Absolutely.
We're supposed to be good stewards of creation.
Absolutely.
Would you like to end in a prayer?
Father, we thank you for your tremendous grace. That you call us to be your children. You call us, O Lord, to care for this environment and to treat it and to treat it very well. We ask, Lord, for conversion of heart, for openness of mind, for soundness of spirit, that, Lord, we may do and live as you ask of us every single day. We make our prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Your Grace.
God bless.